Alariel the Ever Queen is a massive and spectacular miniature, surely the centerpiece of any Sylvaneth army. And in this video, we're going to show you everything that you need to know to get a fantastic result when you're painting yours. Now, we're going to be taking a look at things like the Wardroth Beetle's carapace, how to get that smooth pale skin on Alariel herself, how to get all the really bright green foliage, and of course, how to paint the spear tip of the Spear of Kurnoth. So go grab your paints and brushes, and we'll get started. Before we begin painting, I just want to quickly run you through the sub-assemblies that I've made to make painting the model easier. And basically what I've done is built Alariel and undercoated her with Korax White Spray, and then built the Wardroth Beetle and undercoated that with Chaos Black Spray. Now the reason for these different colours of undercoat will become very apparent as we get further on with the painting. But what we're going to do is start out by painting all the unique features of the Wardroth Beetle. And the biggest part of that is of course the carapace, and that's where we're going to begin. Now the base paint for this is Incubi Darkness, and remember, as always, give all your paints a good shake before you use each colour. And because I'm going to be applying this colour basically almost over the entire beetle, I'm going to be applying it using my large base brush. Now I'm going to make use of a palette here, and this is going to be really useful for a couple of reasons, but mainly it's to allow me to thin down my paint, and that's important because as I apply this, I don't want it to clog up any detail, and I also don't want it to leave any brush marks showing either. So what I'm going to do is add a bit of water. Be careful with these brushes, you can absorb too much water at once, you just need a little bit, you just need to use the corner there of the brush, and then mixed in there like that, so a little bit more I think. And there we go, you're looking for that sort of consistency there. And then all you have to do is just load up this paint on your brush, then start painting it onto the carapace of the beetle. So we're looking really at here, painting the majority of it, and that's going to include the claws as well. Don't worry about other details for now, things like the fungus we've got on here and also the branches and things, because we're going to paint all those later on. But something to be wary of is that there's actually quite a bit of fragile detail on the beetle, especially around here close to the abdomen. Be careful of these parts because you don't want to break any of them off as you're applying this colour. Now you might need to apply two thin coats of this colour as well to build up to a nice strong finish, but remember to keep those coats thin so that you don't obscure any of the detail. With that base colour established, we're now ready to start bringing out some of the detail on the Wardroth Beetle's carapace. But the thing about the detail on it is that some of it's quite shallow. So to bring it out, what I'm going to do is dry brush it to get a nice smooth transition from the darker areas to the lighter areas. Now the colour for this is going to be Thunderhawk Blue Dry Paint, and I'm going to apply it with a medium dry brush. And you could use a larger dry brush if you wanted to, but the reason I'm using this medium one is because of the fragile detail on the miniature. I basically just don't want to break any of it with the brush as I'm applying this, you see. But you could use a larger one if you wanted to. So what you've got to do is just work that paint in amongst the bristles and get rid of the excess, and well, then I'll go on the back of the carapace here because the detail's nice on here, you'll see what I'm doing. Basically what you do is just start lightly flicking the brush across the miniature like this, so that all those kind of swirls and ridges start to gradually be brought out. So you see, just work away at it until it gets stronger and stronger. See, now it's starting to appear there, and basically just work your way across the entire miniature doing this. I finished building up the Thunderhawk Blue dry brush, and you can see it's just helping out to bring out all those shallower ridges on the beetle's carapace. And what we're going to do now is something, well, a bit unusual. Basically, I'm going to use shades and glazes to start deepening the colour of the carapace to bring it to the final result that we want to be at. I'm going to start out with a shade, and the shade is Druki Violet, and this is for all the purple parts on the carapace. And I'm going to apply it with a medium shade brush because I want to be fairly controlled about where exactly I'm going to put this. But what you need to do is just build up a good amount of this on your palette so you know exactly how much you got on your brush. Get it loaded up and, well, start painting onto the areas that are going to be purple. Now, in this case, what we're looking at really is the underside of each of these three horns and also the beetle's face. And all you're looking to do is just apply this over that entire area, just being careful where I get to that line where it's going to be blue above it. So that's going to be just on top of here. So we get a nice, neat, straight line there. But when we get towards the base of these horns, we kind of need to have this shade fading out for where it's going to meet the blue later on. Now, to do this, all you got to do is get the shade down to roughly where you want it to fade out, about there. And then just wash your brush, make sure it's still wet, so still damp, and then basically what you do is just pull some of this shade down, further down like that, so as it gets diluted with water, it fades out into the Incubi Darkness beneath. The Druki Violet is now completely dry, and you can see the effect is subtle at this point, but that's okay because we are going to be building it up more. But what we need to do now is switch to all the other areas of the carapace because these are going to be bluish. So we're going to use Gulliman Blue Glaze to do this. Now, I'm going to be applying this in the same kind of way as what we did with the Druky Violet, and so I'm going to start out with my medium shade brush for areas like the horns, but because we are doing so much more with this colour, it's a good idea to have a large shade brush on hand for the more open areas, for example, the abdomen and things like that. But all you've got to do is build up a good amount of this on your palette so you know how much you have on your brush, and then it's just a case of applying this to all the areas of the carapace that you didn't coat with Druky Violet earlier. So I'm going to start up here and start applying it onto this area like that. Again, just being careful on that ridge there where it transitions to the purple areas. But like the Druky Violet, there are areas where we need to get kind of a fadeaway as it transitions between one colour and the other. So what I'm going to do is just build up a little bit more of that Gilliban blue just down here. And then, like before, all you've got to do is just wash your brush, make sure it's damp, not too much water on there. And then all you do is just get some of that Gilliban blue and just draw it upwards over the purple. I've allowed the Gilliman blue to dry completely, and here you can see the result is once again subtle, so what we need to do now is basically make these colours stronger. So we're going to go back to Druky Violet first of all, and then onto Gilliman blue once again, and we're going to keep on applying these in the same areas until we've got the result that we want. And I'm expecting to have to apply each twice, but we'll see how we get on. I'm going to use Druky Violet first of all, and I'm going back to my medium shade brush for this, and basically the application for this is exactly the same as what we did previously for Druky Violet. So get some loaded up on your palette, onto your brush, and then all you've got to do is start applying this to all the areas that are purple. So I'm going to start on this horn up here, and I'm just going to apply it to the same area. And as before, when you get to the area where it starts to fade out into where it's going to be blue, remember just to use some water just to clean your brush and draw the colour out so it fades away. With the Druky Violet completely dry, we're now going back to Gilliman Blue to reapply it to all the areas that we applied it previously. And remember, as before, be sure to fade it out whenever you're transitioning into the areas that are purple. Let the Gilliman Blue dry completely, and then we're going back to Druky Violet, once again apply to all the areas that are going to be purple, and you apply this in exactly the same way as before. That last coat of Druky Violet's now completely dry, so we're ready to move on to the final coat of Gilliman Blue, once again applied in the same areas where we want it to be bluer, and once this is completely dry, we can move on to painting the highlights. I finished applying the shade in the glaze, and you can see now we've got a lovely deep colour on the carapace. Now you might notice as this catches the light, you get some odd little patches appearing on the actual colours that we've done, but don't worry about that, we are going to fix that up later on, but first of all, we need to highlight it. Now we're going to highlight the purple areas first of all, and we're going to begin with an edge highlight of Xerius Purple, and then a finer highlight of Pink Horror to add a bit of warmth to it, and finally a very small amount of Slaanesh Grey to finish it off. But starting with Xerius Purple, I'm going to use my small layer brush, and to edge highlight, what you need to do is make use of your palette for this to control the paint. Basically, just build up a little patch of it there on your palette, then add some water to thin it down. You don't need loads, just need to make sure it's flowing smoothly from your brush, and also use the palette just to twist your brush to bring the bristles to a nice point like that, so you've got lots of control. And you can always test the paint on your palette to make sure, there you see, I'm getting some nice neat lines. And basically what you do is look for all the sharp details on the purple areas, and well, follow them by painting a line along them. So for example, on the horn we've got here, what I'm going to do is just follow that ridge down there like that, just to pick it out. And you might find that, well, you need to build it to a strong colour here, so you might need to add a second coat to build it up. But basically doing this is all about just taking your time and being as neat as you can. Once you've finished applying that highlight, the next colour to use is Pink Horror. Now this is going to be another edge highlight, and basically you want to follow where you highlighted previously, only not quite so much. Instead, focus it more towards the sharper tips of things, such as on this horn. So you see this time I'm following that highlight, but not going all the way down there. Just focusing it towards that sharper point. The final highlight for the purple areas is Slaanesh Grey. Now this is going to be a very small highlight, so I switched my Artificer brush. And basically what you're looking to do is just paint a very small amount of this at the very sharpest points of these areas on the purple. So just little bits like that. Now on the face, you're still doing exactly the same thing. So look for things like these tusks we got down here and just pick out just the very ends of them there like that. And the same is true as well on the teeth. With that fine highlight applied, we've now finished all the purple areas, and what we need to do now is basically start highlighting all the blue parts. So what we're going to do for this is use edge highlighting again, following the same sort of method, but first we're going to start with Thunderhawk Blue for an edge highlight, and then a much finer edge highlight of Fenrisian Grey. But starting with Thunderhawk Blue, I'm going to go back to my small layer brush to apply this, and as before, you just need to make use of your palette to make sure that the paint is flowing nice and smoothly. So be sure to add a little bit of water in there, mix it together, and then just make sure you've got that good tip on your brush, and that you don't have too much paint on it. And well, really what you're looking to do here is follow the same technique as before. It's just there's much more of it this time. So I'm gonna start up here on this horn in the center, and you're just looking for those sharper edges, basically as neat as you can. You just follow them with the tip of your brush just to pick them out like that. Now, for other areas of it, such as on the back towards the abdomen, basically it's the same kind of thing, but remember that dry brushing we did earlier on has already picked out a lot of these details, so you don't have to do all of them. You're just looking for the more prominent ones, such as on the back of the carapace, just here. Once you've finished applying that highlight, the next thing to do is to add a second highlight, but this time with Fenrisian Grey, using your Artificer brush, and this is to be focused on all the sharper areas of these details. So for example, this corner that we got on the back of the carapace here, and also things like spikes, such as this one down here. I've finished applying the fine highlight now, and here you can see the final carapace with its blue and purple all completed. However, remember earlier on, I did mention that you might get a slightly inconsistent finish on these colours, and that's because of the amount of shade and glaze that we've applied. Now to fix this, it's a very simple job. All you need is Lamia Medium, and basically what we're going to do is apply this all over to get a nice matte varnish finish to it. I'm going to start out with my medium shade brush to apply this, but you might want to have a large shade brush on hand for the larger areas, such as on the back of the beetle. But really all you've got to do is just get some of this ready. Make sure you don't have too much of it on your brush, and it's just a case of applying it all over the carapace. So I'm going to start up here on this horn here, and what I'm looking to do is to apply a nice smooth thin coat across the entire thing. Don't let it build up in the recesses, just keep it even and consistent across all of the carapace. The Lamia Medium is now fully dry, and we've completed the carapace. And with that done, we can now move on to painting some other details. Now, the first one we're going to look at is the softer fleshy part of the abdomen, so underneath the carapace. And for this, we're going to start out with the base colour, Demonette Hide. Now, I'm going to be applying this with my medium base brush because it's quite a large open area, so this brush is a good size for it. But what you need to do is get your paint ready on the palette, mixing in a little bit of water so it's nice and smooth. And once you're ready, all you've got to do is basically start base coating this onto this area. So we're looking at around here. And well, you just need to paint the entire area. Now, you do need to apply two thin coats of this to build up to a nice strong finish, but remember, as you're doing this, just be really careful whenever you're getting close to these fragile details, because you don't want to break any of them off as you're applying this colour. With that base colour built up, we're ready for the next stage, which is to add some shade. Now, we're going to go for Druky Violet for this, and I'm going to be applying it using my medium shade brush, which is a good size for the kind of area I want to cover. You don't want to be putting on too much at once, because we don't want to lose control of it and have it dripping off the model or anything. So, for that reason, use your palette to get it ready and get a good amount on your brush, and all you're looking to do is to paint this over all the areas that we previously base coated. So I'm looking for all this area here, making sure it settles nicely in all the little details we've got here. But on some of these flatter areas, you might find it dries a little bit awkwardly. Now, if it does, don't worry about it, because we are going to be layering over that once it's completely dry. Once the shade's fully dry, we're ready to start layering the softer parts of the abdomen. I'm going to do this in a very specific way to build up that texture that we got on there. So I'm going to use Warp Fiend Grey to do this, and I'm going to be applying it with my small layer brush. And basically what we want to do is apply this colour as a series of lines. So to help doing that, make sure you thin your paint down with some water. And what you're looking to do is to get a good tip on your brush so that the paint's flowing really smoothly from it and you're in lots of control. So you want it to be kind of like that, really. And what you do is apply this in a very specific way. You can see we've got these wrinkles on the abdomen that are kind of like running downwards on it. What I'm going to do is basically follow those lines. So what you do is just start applying this colour like this, always in this direction, building up as a series of lines, because you see doing this is basically emphasising that texture that we've got on these parts. Now also, you want to paint along these ridges too, in which case just be as careful as possible as you paint the raised area of it. But other than that, it's just a case of carrying on doing this and really take your time doing it to build up that texture. Once you finish building up that layer, there's just one more thing left to do to finish off this part of the Wardroth Beetle, and that's to highlight it. Now for this, I'm going to be using Slaanesh Grey and my small layer brush once again, and basically the technique I'm going to do here is pretty much the same thing as what we've just done, and I'm going to be doing a lot less of it this time. So as before, make sure you thin your paint down so it's flowing nice and smoothly, make sure you don't have too much on your brush, and what you're looking to do is once again start painting those lines onto this part of the beetle, but just be more selective about where exactly you place this. So I'm going to avoid any areas where the paint's darker, where we can still see some of the shade showing through, and I'm just going to add a few lines on here like that just to help build up that texture just a little bit more. And once done this, this part of the beetle will be complete. And with that highlight applied, the abdomen is now complete, and we can move on to the next detail. This is going to be the claws on all of the legs. Now these we have already base coated with Incubi Darkness earlier on, and in fact we glazed them as well. So what we're going to do is jump straight onto layering them, and we're going to begin with Rust Grey, and then we're going to shade all over them with Nuln Oil. Now once that shade's completely dry, I'm going to reapply Rust Grey to start to highlight them, and then we're going to add some fine highlights, first of all with Fenrisian Grey, and then a very small amount of Ulthuan Grey. But starting out with Rust Grey, I'm going to use my medium base brush for this. It's a good size for this kind of thing that we're doing here. And what I'm looking to do is to get the paint ready, as usual, thin down so it's going to flow into the miniature nice and smoothly. So a little bit more, I think. There we go. And all you've got to do is basically paint the ends of the claws. So I'm going to start on these large ones that we've got on the front legs here. And this is the kind of area I'm looking to paint, basically all of this part along here. And you can see, because it's a layer paint, I will have to apply two thin coats to build up to a nice strong finish. But just remember to be really careful whenever you're getting close to these segments at the bottom here, where the claw meets the carapace. The next stage is to shade the claws with your medium shade brush using Nuln Oil, and you're looking to get as even a coat as possible over here, so just move it around till it settles smoothly, and once you've done this, be sure to give it plenty of time to dry. About 15 minutes should be fine. With the shade dry, we're now going back to Rust Grey, but this time with a medium layer brush, and what I'm looking to do is to reapply this layer, but this time just to the top side of each claw. So you see that central ridge down this one here? I'm looking to get a nice neat line between it and the darker colour just beneath. With that layer applied, we're now ready to begin highlighting, and we're going to start with Fenrisian Grey using the small layer brush, and this is to be an edge highlight following all the sharpest edges on the claws. The final colour to complete the claws is Ulthuan Grey, and this is just for a very fine edge highlight, so I've used my Artificer brush, and basically I'm just going to paint this towards all the sharpest corners on the claws, so up along the top here, and also of course down towards the tips of each one as well. And there we are, the claws are now complete, and we can move on to the next area of detail, which is going to be all around the beetle's face. Now we're going to start out by painting its mandibles, and the first colour for this will be Karak Stone. And I'm going to be applying it with my small base brush because, well, these details are quite small, and actually they're sort of embedded in amongst a lot of detail that we've already painted so far, so you must be careful with this part. So make sure to thin your paint down so it's flowing nice and smoothly, so you've got a good consistency, kind of like that, and not too much on your brush, and all you need to do is start applying this to the mandibles. Now, I'm going to start on this one just down here, and what I want to do is get a nice straight line up at the top of it there, just carefully there, and then basically paint all the rest of it. And you will need to apply two thin coats of this colour to build up to a strong finish as well. With the Karak Stone applied, we're now ready to add some shade, and I'm going to go for Agraxer Shade for this, and because these details are so small, I'm going to stick to my small base brush to apply this, so I've got lots of control over where exactly I'm putting this. But all you've got to do is just get a good little puddle of this onto your palette so you can control how much is on your brush, and when you're ready, you've just got to apply it over the mandibles that we've painted so far. So I'm just going to start on this one once again. As you're doing this, just be careful around all the smaller details and just try and get a nice even finish as it dries. And once you are finished, give it about 10 minutes to dry fully. Once the shade's dry, all we've got to do is highlight the mandibles to finish them off. And for this, I'm going to be using Pallid Witch Flesh. I'm going to apply it with the Artificer brush as well, because we want some control for this part. So be sure to make use of your palette to thin the paint down, and get that good tip on your brush. And when you're ready, all you're looking to do is to pick out all those sharp edges. So an edge highlight, really. And I'm going to start on this one round here again. And what you're looking to do is just keep your hands as steady as possible and follow all those sharper edges. The mandibles are now complete, and we're ready for the next detail, which is going to be the eyes. Now to do this, we just need two colours. We're going to first of all apply some White Scar, and then we're going to glaze them using Bloodletter to give them a nice red glow. But starting out with White Scar, I'm going straight to my Artificer brush first of all here, because, well, the eyes are tiny, so we need lots of control for this. So be sure to thin your paint down so it's flowing really smoothly, but remember to be careful not to get too much of the paint on your brush so you don't lose control of it. So use your palette for that, and when you're ready, what you've got to do is, well, basically, hold the model as steadily as possible, and just very gently touch your brush to the surface of each eye. The next stage is to add some Bloodletter glaze, and for this you just want to paint over the actual eye and the area around it as well, just to get a nice hint of red, and for this I'm using my small layer brush. And there we are, the eyes are painted and the face is now complete. And we can move on to the next detail, which is another small one. It's going to be the fungus growing on the side of the beetle next. Now, this is going to be base coated with Corn Red and then layered using Squig Orange. After that, I'm going to apply some Agrax Earthshade to shade them, and then finally we'll finish with a highlight of Kislev Flesh. But starting out with our base color, corn red, I'm going for my small base brush for this because these details are small, so you'll want lots of control here. And as usual, make use of your palette to get our paint under control. So thin it down so it's flowing nice and smoothly, and make sure you've got a good tip on your brush. And when you're ready, all you've got to do is start base coating these bits of fungus. I'm going to start on these ones that are on the side here, and you can see them just sticking out the side of the carapace. Just need to get a nice even base coat on here, and to get a nice strong finish, I do recommend two thin coats. Now, this isn't actually the only area of fungus on the model. There is some more just up here underneath this branch at the back here. Now, I'll just mark it red so you can see it just up there. You can paint these parts now if you want to, or you can come back to them later after we've painted the bark, which is exactly what I'm going to do, because you'll find doing it that way around just makes painting these details just a little bit easier. The next colour to apply is squig orange, and for this I'm going to be applying it in quite a specific way, so I'm using my small airbrush for this, and what I'm going to do is start by angling the model like this so I can paint a nice neat edge highlight along the edge of each of these mushrooms along here like that, and then I'm going to layer completely underneath for the softer fleshier part underneath. The next step is to add some shade, and I'm going for Agrax Earthshade for this, still with a small airbrush, and what you need to do is just apply this over each bit of the fungus, but don't put on so much that you lose control of it when you get down to the carapace. The final colour to complete the fungus is Kislev Flesh, and this is just going to be a very fine edge highlight, so I'm using my Artificer brush, and what I'm looking to do is just to paint a small amount along the edge of each of these mushrooms. And there we go, those details are now complete, and we can move on to the next one, which is going to be to paint the soul seeds that are hanging from beneath the Wardroth beetle. Now all of these are quite fragile, so be careful as you paint in this part, but all of them are painted in the same way. We're going to start out with a base coat of Celestra Grey, then we'll layer all over them using Ulthurn Grey, and then we'll finish them off by tinting them green by applying some Collier Green shade to them. But starting out with our base colour of Celestra Grey, I'm going to use my small base brush to apply this, and you just need to, as usual, use your palette to thin the paint down with a bit of water so it's nice and smooth. There's some fine detail on these, we don't want to clog any of that up, so you want to make sure the paint's nice and thin. There we go, and when you're ready, all you've got to do is start base coating these areas. And I'm going to start on this one just here, and looking to get a nice even coat across the whole thing, and I do recommend two thin coats to build up to a nice strong finish. And don't worry about the details at the top for now, because we are going to be painting all of those later on. Next, apply a layer of Ulthurn Grey to each of the soul seeds, and remember to keep the paint thin so that you don't clog up any of the detail on each one. Then to complete the soul seeds, add a coat of Collier Green shade over each one. What you're looking to do is get a nice even layer here so that it settles mostly in the recessed areas to bring out that little rune on there. Just let it settle a bit more towards the bottom as well, so that the green just gets a bit stronger towards the bottom of each one. The shade is dry, and there we go, the soul seeds are now finished, and we're going to move on to the next part, and actually we're going to be moving away from the Wardroth beetle for the time being and start to paint the unique features on Alariel. And we're going to begin with the biggest feature, which is her skin. Now remember, we undercoated this part of the model using Corax White Spray Undercoat, and that's going to enable us to do a really bright colour straight away, so we're going to go to Flayed One Flesh for the skin. Now this I'm going to be applying with my medium layer brush, and the real key thing here is, got to remember, we want to get a really smooth result to the skin here, so you must make sure you thin your paint down with some water. In fact, thin it down a little bit more than usual. So you're looking for about that sort of consistency there. In fact, just a little bit thinner, I think. There we go. So you're looking for it to be kind of like that before you apply it. And because we're applying this over a white undercoat, you will find the colour will take pretty quickly. And all you've got to do then is basically paint this onto all of her skin. And I'm going to start up here on the face, and you're looking to get a nice smooth coat there, just like that. With the Flayed One Flesh applied, we're now ready to add some shade to give a bit more definition to the skin. So I'm going to use Reichlin Flesh Shade to do this, and I'm going to apply it still with my medium layer brush. And well, the real key to this part is to make sure you put on the right amount, and this brush is the ideal size for it. Basically, you want to put on enough that you get definition in the detail, but not so much that you darken the skin too much. So what I'm going to do is use the palette to control exactly how much I have on my brush. And when you've got about the right amount, all you've got to do is, well, I recommend picking a section at a time and applying this shade all over it. So I'm going to start up on the face once again. And what I'm looking to do is to get a nice even coat there to just bring out that detail. But be aware that if you get too much shade on, for example, if I just put way too much on there, remember you can use your brush like a sponge to absorb it and move it away there like that to keep it nice and even. And remember to do that whilst each part's still wet. So that's why I recommend you pick one part at a time, complete it till you're happy with it before you move on to the next. Once that shade is fully dry, you'll see all those details standing out nicely, but it has darkened down the skin a bit, so what we need to do now is re-establish that mid-tone. So we're going to go back to Flayed One Flesh and reapply it, only this time a little bit more carefully. I'm going to use my small layer brush for this, and what you need to do is prepare the paint just as how we had it previously, so add some water to it to thin it down so it's nice and smooth, because we want it to dry with some transparency to it. So that sort of consistency there, and just get rid of the excess off your brush so you've got a good tip on there. And then what you're looking to do this time is apply it to most of the skin, but look carefully for any areas where the shade's settled and just avoid those parts. So if we start up here on the face, what I'm going to do is keep my hands as steady as possible and just paint down the centre of the nose there like that. And then where the shade's settled at the side of it next to the bridge, I'm just going to avoid that and then start painting up here on the cheek there like that. And then we've got a bit more shade settled just in there underneath the cheek, so I'm going to carry on underneath it like that, and then like that. And see, this way I'm keeping the skin smooth, but I'm starting to bring out the details even more. So what you need to do now is just carry on doing this all over the rest of the skin. With that mid-tone re-established, we're now ready to highlight the skin. And to do this, I'm going to be using Pallid Witch Flesh. And I'm going to be using my Artificer brush for this for as much control as possible. And what we're looking to do is some line highlights. So to do that, make use of the palette to once again thin down the paint and get it so it's flowing nice and smoothly. And like with the layering earlier on, make sure to thin it just a little bit more than you would normally, so the paint's really smooth, to get that nice smooth finish to it. And what we're looking to do is get that good tip on your brush, and then on your miniature, you're looking to pick out any sharper details. So the face, for example, what I'm going to do is look for sharp things such as the bridge of the nose. So just a line of this down the very centre. There we go. And then areas like the top of the cheeks, just catching that cheekbone. So just along there like that. We've got the jawline too, so just down here. And so basically just looking to carry on going around all the skin, picking out things like this. So keep an eye out for things like the knees, the fingers, elbows, that kind of thing. I finished applying the sharp highlight to the skin and you can see it looks great, but because this model's so special, I'm just going to go a little bit further and add another highlight to it. Now you don't have to do this if you don't want to, because this is going to be a little bit unusual. Basically what I want to do is have a very soft highlight to emphasise the softness of the skin. Now I'm still going to use Pallid Witch Flesh for this, but I'm going to dilute it using Larmium Medium. And the reason why I'm using Larmium Medium here is because basically it's like a paint but with no pigment into it. So when I mix it with a paint, I dilute the colour of it, but I retain the properties of the paint, so it will keep a nice smooth finish to it as it dries. Perfect for what we want here. So I'm going to use Pallid Witch Flesh and I'm going to use my Artificer brush for this, and what you need to do is just get some of this and put it onto your palette, and then be sure to wash your brush so you don't contaminate the medium with any colour. And what I'm looking to do is add lots of it. So I'm going to start out with one brush load here and basically mix them together. So I'm creating a very diluted version of the paint here like that. So you want this sort of consistency of what I've got here. Make sure you don't have too much of it on your brush. Then all you need to do is apply this smoothly and thinly to any of the more raised areas of the skin. So a nice example here is on the leg. Basically what I'm going to do is paint it towards the middle of these areas here. So a very thin coat, you see, like this, keeping some of that Flayed One Flesh showing as I get close to the recesses. So I've almost got some different stages here. So you can see the paint I've just applied, then the Flayed One Flesh just there, going down into the shade there like that. And this way I'm getting a lovely smooth highlight on that area of the skin. And there we are, the skin is complete. And we can move on now to the next detail, which is going to be to paint the dress. Now, there's actually two areas of colour to this. We're going to paint the inside and outside of it differently. And we're going to start with the inside just because it's a bit trickier to get to. Now, the first colour for this is going to be Caliban Green for a nice dark green base coat. And then we're going to shade the recesses with Norn Oil. After that, we're going to highlight it, first of all, with Lauren Forest, and then a very fine highlight of Elysian Green. But starting with our base colour, Caliban Green, and this I'm going to be applying with my small base brush. And really, the most important thing about this is just to take your time and be careful with it, because we don't want to get any of this colour on the skin that we just finished. So you absolutely must make sure you thin your paint down so you've got lots of control over it. Get rid of the excess on your palette and get that good tip on your brush. And all you've got to do is just take your time angling the model so you can get to these areas of the dress really easily. So I'm going to start down here, and you can see what I mean about having to be careful whenever you're getting close to that skin. Just really take your time. And on the more open areas, the flatter areas such as around here, you might still see some of that white undercoat showing through. And if you do, it's not a problem. Just let this first coat dry, then apply another one in exactly the same way. Once you've finished building up that base coat, the next colour to add is Norn Oil to be applied into all the recesses of the fabric. So basically you're looking at creases like the one I've got here, and to keep as much control as possible, I'm applying it with my small layer brush. Once the shade's fully dry, we're ready to highlight, and we're going to start with Lauren Forest using the small layer brush still, and this is for all the sharpest edges on the fabric. So we're looking around the very edge of the dress, such as along here, and also the tops of any creases as well. And finally, add a second highlight, this time of Elysian green, and this is just to be focused on the very sharpest corners of the fabric. With the inside of the dress painted, we're now ready to start painting the outside of the dress. And we're going to begin this with an edge paint. We're going to use Baharoth Blue, because it's a nice bright colour, perfect for what we want here. But because we undercoated with Corax White, this paint will take well over the undercoat. Now I'm going to be applying it using my medium layer brush, and this is going to be like when we painted the inside of the dress. Really, it's all about neatness, so you must take your time as you do this. Make sure to thin your paint down so that you don't have too much on your brush as well. So looking for that sort of consistency there, and as I say, not too much on the brush. And all you've got to do is start applying this all over the outside of the dress. Now, a lot of this does go very close to the skin, so be as neat as you can whenever you get close to those parts so that you don't go over it. And when you do get to the parts where you're going to be meeting the green of the inside of the dress, what you can do is use the edge of your brush just to run along that corner there to get a nice, neat, straight line that goes between the two colours there like that. But otherwise, just really take your time with this stage because some of the detail is quite intricate, so just take your time to make sure that you get it all. I've applied two thin coats of Baharoth Blue to get a nice even finish, and now I'm ready to add some shade. I'm going to be using Collier Green shade for this, and I'm going to apply it still with my medium layer brush, because like when we were applying the Baharoth Blue, the real trick here is to be careful about, keeping it under control basically, just being neat as you can. So make sure you use your palette for this so you know exactly how much shade you have on your brush, and not too much at once, you see, it's a good idea to keep in control of it. And when you're ready, all you've got to do is start applying this all over the outside of the dress. I'm going to start just on here, and once again, remember, just be as neat as you can, especially when you're getting close to the skin. The shade is now completely dry, and you can see it's just bringing out all the folds and creases in the dress. And what we need to do now is basically re-establish that mid-tone, so we're going to go back to Baharoth Blue to reapply that as a layer. Now this time I'm going to be applying it with my small layer brush because I want lots of control as to where exactly I'm going to put it. And always make sure to thin it down on your palette so that it's nice and smooth as well, because we want to keep that smoothness as we can continue painting the dress. So you want it thinned down to be kind of like that, and what I'm looking to do is to apply this to all the more raised areas of it. So what I'm going to do is look carefully for any areas where the shade has settled the most, for example that little crease there, and basically I'm just going to avoid that detail whilst painting either side of it there like that. Now you can see this colour is quite thin, so we'll need to apply two thin coats of it, but because it's thin, it's easy to get a nice smooth transition from the darker colours to the lighter colours by, well, just keeping it thin like this. I finished layering with the Baharoth Blue, and you can see now the dress is much brighter and we're ready to highlight it. I'm going to do this first of all with White Scar, which is quite a jump from Baharoth Blue, but it is just the first stage of the highlighting, so you'll see how we'll bring it together in a minute. Now I'm going to be applying this with my Artificer brush, and this is going to be an edge highlight, so as usual make sure to thin your paint down so it's flowing nice and smoothly, and most importantly you've got that good tip on your brush so you're in lots of control as to where exactly you're applying this. And when you're ready, what you're looking for are all the sharpest creases of the fabric. So if I start down here, you can see we've got this one here, this bit of shading that's down the centre there. What I'm going to do is just highlight the raised side of it. So just along there, a nice neat line of White Scar following that down there like that. And well, basically you just need to carry on now looking for all the creases and just picking them out like this. And also be sure to get the edge of the dress as well. I finished applying the highlight, but like I said, it is quite stark, so what we need to do now is just add another highlight, a soft highlight this time, of White Scar again, but this time mixed with Lamy Medium. So this is going to be like what we were doing on the skin earlier on. Now I'm going to be using my small layer brush for this, and we need to just start out with some White Scar. You don't need loads, but just pop that onto your palette, and then we need to dilute it with Lamy Medium. So I think I'm going to go for about two brushfuls of this, so one, and then just a little bit more, I think. And there we go. And then I'm just going to start mixing them together to get into a nice smooth consistency. So you can see it's very thin, what I'm looking for here. And I don't want too much of this on my brush at once. I want to be very careful about how much I'm applying so I don't overwhelm it. You can always add more if you want to, but it's harder to take it away. And what we're looking to do is to basically apply this to the smoother areas of the dress next to where those highlights are. So for example, just there, see a very thin coat of it, just to soften that transition from the white highlight to the Baharoth Blue beneath there like that. So you see I'm just being very careful picking out all these smoother parts, leaving the recesses, and getting a nice smooth highlight like this. So all you need to do now is carry on applying this all over the dress. And with that soft highlight applied, the dress is now complete. And you can just notice as well, I forgot to paint the hood earlier, but it's now been painted as well in exactly the same way as the rest of the dress. And with that done, we can move on to the next area of detail. And this is going to be your hair, which is going to be blonde. We're going to do something a little bit unusual here. Basically, I'm going to paint most of it using a shade. And for this to work, it is important that all the hair is white first of all. So if it's still all Corax White, great. But if you have got a few little splashes of other colours onto it so far, you can neaten those up with Orthoan Grey, which is a very, very close colour to Corax White. Now, the first first shade we're going to use on this is Seraphim Sepia, and this will give us a nice blonde colour, and then we're going to highlight that using Pallid Witch Flesh. But first of all, with Seraphim Sepia, what you need to do is get hold of your medium layer brush, and we're going to use this to apply it. You need to get a good amount on your palette so that you're applying plenty at once so it settles nice in the detail, but not so much that you lose control of it. So get a good amount on your brush, and all you have to do is start applying this to the hair, and you'll see straight away as I start painting this on, it settles nicely in all that recessed detail and gives us a fantastic colour for the blonde hair. Once that shade's completely dry, the next thing to do is to highlight the hair using Pallid Witch Flesh and your Artificer brush. And what you're looking to do here is look for all the sharpest strands that are standing out from the shade and just pick them out with neat lines of this colour. So just take your time with the stage and be as neat as you can. And there we are, the hair is complete, and we're going to move on to the next part, and this is going to be the Sol Amphorae. And there are five of these that are actually on both on Alariel, there's one of them there, and then there's four more on the Wardroth Beetle. And I'm going to show you how to paint these using the Wardroth Beetle for an example, because it's much clearer there, but the technique is the same on both parts of the final assembly. Now the base colour we're going to use for this is Celestra Grey, and this I'm going to start by applying with my medium base brush, because these Amphorae are quite large, so it's a good sized brush for it. But on Alariel in particular, some of the detail is quite tricky to get to, so it's a good idea to have a small base brush for those sort of parts. But what you've got to do is just thin your paint down so it's nice and smooth, and when you're ready, you just got to start applying this to these areas. And I'm going to start on these ones back up here, and you just need to apply a nice smooth base coat, and as you can see, some of that colour is still showing through, so I will be applying two thin coats to get to a nice strong finish. With that base colour established, we're now ready to brighten the Sol Amphorae up just a little bit more and bring them closer to white, and we're going to use Orthoan Grey to do this. Now this time I'm going to be applying the colour using my medium layer brush, but really the technique is the same kind of thing as what we just did basically. You're looking to paint all of them with this colour, but still be sure to thin your paint down so you get a nice smooth finish to it. Good for about that sort of consistency. Make sure you don't have too much on your brush so you're not applying too much at once. And really now it's just a case of layering all over them. So I'm going to start on these again, and you're just looking to get a nice smooth coat. So for that reason, you want to apply two thin coats to build up to a nice strong finish. Once you've finished building up that Orthoan Grey, the next thing to do is to add the purple tint to the Sol Amphorae. And to do this, we're going to be using Druky Violet, once again mixed with Lamia Medium just to dilute it a little bit and keep a nice smooth finish to it. And we want the purple to get more intense towards the bottom of each of these things as well. So what I'm going to do is apply this mix three separate times, and it's important that each one is dry before you start the next one. But to begin with the first one, I'm going to be using my medium layer brush for this, and what you want to do is have a mix that's roughly even, slightly more Lamia Medium though than the Druky Violet. So once again, make sure to clean your brush before you get the medium so you don't contaminate it, and then mix that together. So you're looking for about that sort of consistency to it, and all you've got to do is get plenty loaded up on your brush and then apply it over each of these. I'm going to start on these ones once again, but the technique is exactly the same on all of them. Just make sure it settles nicely in this quite soft detail we've got at the top here. But be aware on Alariel, the detail can be quite tricky to get to, so just take your time with that part of the model. Once the first coat's completely dry, I'm going to apply a second coat to the same mix, but this time I'm only going to focus on the lower half of each Amphorae. So you see, by doing this, I'm making the purple just a bit stronger towards the bottom. But also be sure to keep the coat thin, so that as you get to this transition point here, the colour fades out as it gets lighter towards the top. With that second coat completely dry, I'm now going to add a third of the same mix, but this time I'm focusing it just towards the lower quarter of each Amphorae, so the purple just gets a little bit stronger towards the end of each. And with the final coat of that mix applied, the main body of the Sol Amphorae is now done. There are still some metallic details to do on them, but we're going to come back to those later on, because the next thing we're going to paint is all the leather and twine, and all of this is done the same way and appears on both Alariel and the Wardroth Beetle, so be sure to get all of it. Now we're going to start out with the base colour, Dryad Bark, for all of these, and then we're going to shade them using Norm Oil. Once that's completely dry, we'll add a fine highlight of Gorthor Brown. But to start with our base colour of Dryad Bark, I'm going to use my small base brush for most of this, but some of these details are very small, so you might want to have a small layer brush on hand for any of those parts that are just tricky to get to, you see. So whatever the case though, just need to make sure you thin your paint down, and when you're ready, it's just a case of locating these details and painting them. And I'm going to start on the belt on Alariel, and it's all just a case of keeping your hands as steady as possible and taking your time as you base coat these details. The next stage is to shade all the leather and twine using Norn Oil. Now, because these details are so small, I'm using my small layer brush for this, and it's really important that you don't put on too much at once, because you don't want to lose control of the shade. Once the shade's completely dry, the next thing to do is to highlight all the leather and twine. And for this, we're going to use Gorthol Brown, applied with the Artificer brush. And what you look to do is to pick out all the sharpest edges as neatly as you can to give it a nice highlight just to finish it off. And once you've finished applying that highlight, all the leather and twine is complete. And now we're going to start painting all the metallic parts, which are all gold. And these parts appear, well, all over the model. They're both on the Lariel and the Wardroth Beetle, and all of them are going to be painted in the same way. Now we're going to start out with the base colour, Balthazar Gold, for all of these. And then we'll shade them with Reichland Flesh Shade to give them a bit of warmth. After that, we're going to layer with Sycorax Bronze, then finish off with a highlight of Runefang Steel. But beginning with Balthazar Gold, I'm going to start out with my medium base brush, which, well, is quite large for this, but this is just for a Lariel only, for the bigger details on it, things like the headdress, that kind of thing. But it's a good idea to have a small base brush on hand, and in fact, a small layer brush is a good idea too, because a lot of these gold details are very small, so just be aware of that before you begin. What we've got to do is get your paint ready, so it's thinned down and nice and smooth, and all you've got to do is start applying this to all the gold parts. And like I say, I'm going to start up here on the headdress. And for this, you will need to apply two thin coats to build up to a nice consistent finish. But remember, just take your time and be really careful whenever you're getting close to any of the details that you've painted so far. With the gold base coater, we're now ready to shade it. And the colour for this is Reichland Flesh Shade. And I'm going to start off applying it up here with my medium layer brush. But I've got my small layer brush on hand for all the finer details. And remember, just be really careful as you apply this so that you don't lose control of it. Once the shade is completely dry, the next step is to layer all of the gold using Sycorax Bronze. Now this time I'm using my small layer brush, and what I'm looking to do is to paint most of it, but avoid the areas where the shade has settled. So for example, on the headdress here, you can see I'm painting towards the middle of these flatter areas, and then the raised detail, well, I'm just going to leave the shade in between the flat areas and the raised parts, and then paint those raised parts as well, like this. The final stage for the gold is to add an edge highlight of Runefang Steel. So for this I'm using my Artificer brush, and I'm just looking for those sharper details like the designs we've got here on the headdress, and I'm just looking to pick them out as neatly as possible using this silver. And there we are, all the gold is now complete, and the next detail is going to be just for Alariel only. Basically it's going to be all the gems that are scattered around her. And all of these are going to be purple, so to paint them, we're going to begin with the base colour Naggaroth Knight, and then we're going to shade it using Norn Oil. After that, we'll begin to highlight it, first of all with Genestealer Purple, then a smaller amount of Kislev Flesh, and then we'll finish off with a very tiny amount of White Scar. But beginning with our base colour, Naggaroth Knight, I'm going to go straight to my small layer brush to apply this, because all of these gems are very small, so it's a good idea to have an appropriate size brush for this. So all you've got to do is make sure you've got your paint ready, and then it's a case of just carefully looking around the miniature to pick them all out. Now they're all teardrop shaped, and I'm going to be starting out with this one here that's on this belly plate, and all you've got to do is get a nice even base colour all across the gem. The next step for the gems is to add some Norn Oil, still with your small layer brush, and for this you just want to focus this colour towards the top of each of the gems. With the shade dry, we can now add our first layer paint, which is Genestealer Purple, and this is going to be the same for each gem, just paint some of it on the underneath of each one, so just down there, and then on the left hand side, about halfway up. The next colour to add is Kislev Flesh, and this time I'm using my Artificer brush, and basically what I'm looking to do is to paint this in the same sort of area, just a bit less of it than what we had with the previous colour. So you see, still along the bottom of it, and partway up the side, but just a thinner line this time. The final colour for the gems is White Scar, and for this all you need to do is paint a very small amount in that bottom left hand corner of each gem, and also add a dot of it just below the very peak of it towards the top of each one. And there we are, the gems are complete, and I've also added some Ardcoat Gloss Varnish over them for a nice glassy shine. Whether you do this or not, of course, is entirely up to you. And now we're going to move on to the next feature, which is a big one. It's going to be all the bark, and this appears on both Alariel and on the Wardroth Beetle as well, and all of it we're going to paint in the same way. Now the base colour for this is Dryad Bark, and I'm going to be starting out applying this using my medium base brush, because some of these areas are quite large. But I really do recommend you have a small base brush on hand, because there's some really small details with this, especially on Alariel, those bits of bark that are on her skin, so you need lots of control to get those parts. But it's just a case of getting your paint ready in the usual way, don't have too much on your brush, and then it's a case of just, well, applying this colour to the model. I'm going to start on the Talon of the Dwindling up here, and it's just a case of applying this with two thin coats to get a nice consistent finish, and be really careful when you get close to any of the details that you've finished so far. I finished base coating with dryad bark, and you can see I've been quite messy on the wings, but that's okay because we'll neaten all that up when we come to painting the foliage later on. But now what we need to do is shade all of the bark, and I'm going to be using Nolan oil to do this. I'm going to be applying it using my medium layer brush. Now, the thing about this is you only need to apply this shade to the larger areas of bark, so things like the branches on the Wardroth beetle, the wings, and the talon and the dwindling, which is what I'm going to be starting with. You don't need to worry about painting it onto those bits of bark that are on her skin, because they're so small, they don't really benefit from having this shade on them, and also it's very easy to lose control of the shade on those parts as well. So just look to do the larger areas of bark, and whenever you get close to any of the details, just be neat as you can. With all that shading done, we can now begin to highlight all of the bark. And we're going to start out doing this with Gorthor Brown, and this is going to be for all of it across all the assemblies of the miniature. Now, I'm going to start out by applying this with my medium layer brush, but as you know by now, a lot of this bark is quite small, so have a small layer brush on hand for areas like the bark on Alariel's skin, for example. But all you got to do is just thin your paint down, make sure you've got that good tip on your brush, and then on the bark areas, you're looking for all the more raised details. So I'll start on the talon once again. What I'm looking for is like raised lines such as just along here, and what I'm going to do is paint a line of Gorthor Brown following it. Now you don't have to be super neat with this, you don't have to be really controlled because the bark's quite rough anyway, and all you're going to do is build up that texture. But you want to avoid the areas where the shade has settled the most, just to give a bit of depth to those parts. So I just need to carry on now, doing this all over all the areas of bark. And there we are, with that highlight applied, the bark is nearly finished. But at this point, we just need to focus on Alariel, because if you look at the box art, you can see that the bark on her skin kind of goes green, so it gives the impression of new growth, like saplings, really. So we just need to pause just to focus on painting those bits now. Now, first of all, we're going to apply some Lauren Forest to these as a highlight, and then a small amount of Elysian Green to finish those bits off. And then for all of the bark, we'll complete it with a very fine highlight of Carrick Stone. But first of all, Lauren Forest, I'm going to be using my small layer brush for this because, well, these parts, as you know by now, are very small, so you need lots of control here. So be sure to thin your paint down so it's flowing nice and easily, and you want that transparent nature of layer paints. You really want that here to help it blend in with the colours beneath. So make sure your paint's at that sort of consistency, and all you've got to do is start applying this to these parts. So I'm going to start on here, and because they are raised out of the skin, so long as you keep your hands steady, you can actually use the side of your brush just to catch those raised areas. And what you're looking to do is to layer this paint over these parts, but only about two-thirds of the way down. So leave the brown still showing towards the bottom there, but as you work up further, just add more and more green so the green becomes stronger. If you're unsure exactly which bits to pick out like this, then just check out the box art and you'll see it on there. The next stage is to add some Elysian Green to these details, but this time I'm just not going to paint down quite so far. So I'm going to start at the tips of each one, and we're looking to go about halfway down this time. So this way you see the green gets stronger towards the end of each one. The final colour to apply for the bark is Carrack Stone, and this is only a very small amount just for a final highlight. On these green bits we've been painting, you just need to paint a little bit of this on the very tip of each one, and on the rest of the bark, well, in this case, what you're looking to do is again look for all the sharper details and just apply a small amount on each of them, and you do the same on both the Lariel and the Wardroth Beetle as well. And with that fine highlight applied, all the bark is complete, and now we can move on to painting a very bright colour. This is going to be for Alariel's wings, and we're going for a very bright green for this. I'm going to start out with Elysian Green, which is a layer paint, but I'm going to be applying it with my medium base brush, because this brush is a good size for details of this kind of size. And what you need to do is just get your paint ready in the usual way, and once it's thinned down and it's nice and smooth, all you've got to do is start applying this to the entirety of the foliage on the wings. I'm going to start on this one, and as you do this, just be careful of all the branches that we painted earlier, the brown parts down here. Just want to basically paint down to them, then just go partially over them so you start to get a nice little blend going from the brown to the green in areas like that. But other than that, you just need to make sure you paint all of these, and just be aware that some leaves do appear on the actual branches up here. For example, we've got one just here, and in these areas, you will need to apply two thin coats to build up to a nice strong green before you move on. Once you've finished applying the Elysian Green, the next thing to do is to shade it. And we're going to be using Beltane Green to do this, and this time I'm going to apply it with my medium shade brush because, well, we need quite a lot of this, so a good size brush for this is a good idea. But be careful as you apply. Don't put on too much at once so you don't lose control of it and get any on the details that we've already done. But all you have to do for this is make sure you apply it over all the Elysian Green that we just painted. So just take your time, be as neat as you can, and give it plenty of time to dry once you're done. The Beltane green is now completely dry, and it is very important that it's completely dry before you start this next stage, because to highlight the wings, we're going to dry brush them, and if it's not fully dry, this will make a horrible mess. But once it is dry, what you need is Hexos Pale Sun, and this dry paint I'm going to be applying using my small dry brush. And remember, to dry brush, what you've got to do is just get some of this paint on the end of your brush, and get some tissue, and use a tissue to work that paint in amongst the bristles. Now, you want to make sure you get rid of most of this so that you gradually build up that colour. That is the best way to do this. And once you're ready, it is just a case of lightly running the brush across the wings, very lightly, so that yellow starts to catch the edges and bring out those details. So work away at it, just building up that colour, and be careful as you do this, because there is a lot of fragile detail around here, and you don't want to break any of it whilst you're doing the dry brushing. I finished applying the dry brush, and you can see it's brought out those details nicely, but it has given a slight pastel finish to the green. So what I need to do now is just get back some of that vibrancy and bring the colours together. So to do that, I'm going to glaze it using Lamenta's yellow, and this I'm going to apply with my medium shade brush, because it's a good size for this kind of thing. But basically what you need to do is use your palette to get the glaze under control, and when you're ready, you just need to apply it to all the green that you've done so far. So I'm going to start up here once again, and you can see straight away as I apply this, it becomes much brighter. And with the glaze dry, the wings are now complete. But of course, this isn't the only foliage details we need to paint on Alariel. There's a whole lot more, both on her dress and on the Wardroth Beetle too. Now, you might be wondering why we didn't paint those details at the same time as the wings, and that's because we want the wings to have a slightly different colour. So they stand out a bit more as a special detail. But we do need to paint all that foliage now, so all of it, we're going to start out with the base colour, Caliban Green. Then we'll layer over it with Lauren Forest. Then we'll add some patches of Elysian green for a bit of variety before finishing off with Lamenta's yellow glaze once again to give the green just a bit more punch. But starting out with Caliban Green, I'm going to begin with my small base brush for this, and well, as usual, just switch brush sizes as you need to depending on the size of details that you're painting. But once you've got your paint ready, all you've got to do is start base coating all of these leaves. And I'm going to start with the ones that are on Alariel's dress. And when you're painting these ones over the Corax White undercoat, just be aware that you're willing to apply two thin coats for a nice even finish. Once you've finished applying the base coat, the next colour to use is Lauren Forest, and this is going to be applied to most of these leaves with the medium layer brush, only what you're looking to do is to avoid the recessed areas, still keeping them with the Caliban green showing. So you can see here between these leaves, I'm just keeping that darker colour showing in between them in that recess just there. The next colour to apply is Elysian Green, and this is to pick out any sharper details or raised features on all the leaves and foliage. And with those layers built up, the last step is to apply a Lamenta's yellow glaze to all of the foliage, just to give it a nice bright finish. And when you're doing this, just remember, be careful not to put on too much at once so that you don't lose control of it. And there we are, with the foliage painted, the model is nearly finished. And in fact, the Wardroth Beetle is aside from its base, and we've just got a few more details left to do on Alariel. And the first of those we're going to concentrate on finishing is her spear, starting with the haft of it. Now to do this, we're going to begin with a base coat of Celestra Grey, and then we're going to layer that with Althurn Grey to bring it up to an almost pure white. But starting out with our base colour, Celestra Grey, I'm going to go for my small base brush for this, and all you've got to do is, once again, make use of your palette to make sure the paint's nice and thin and nice and smooth, because you want a nice smooth finish to this for the haft of the pole. And all you've got to do is get your paint ready, and it's just a case of, well, applying this to the pole of the spear. Now, when you're doing this, just be careful of these gold parts that we've got. You can see I was a little bit messy with the gold earlier on because it didn't really match at that stage. But at this point, you just need to be as neat as you can whenever you're getting up to those parts. But other than that, you just want to get a nice smooth coat of this colour. Once you've finished building up the base colour, the next one to apply is Althurn Grey, and this time I'm going to be applying it with a medium layer brush, and essentially I'm going to paint this over all the same areas just to build up to a brighter colour closer towards white. With the haft of the spear now done, we're ready to start painting those four blades, and for this we're going to go for that cool kind of magical appearance to it, and to do it the first colour we need is Thunderhawk Blue. Now this I'm going to apply with my medium layer brush, and this is just that initial colour to get the effect started basically. So what you've got to do is make sure you've got it ready in the usual sort of way, so it's nice and smooth, and it is important that you apply this smoothly for the effect to really look really good. And once you're ready, you've just got to paint all four spear blades. So I'm going to start on this central one here. As you do this, you are going to apply two thin coats as well, just to get a nice even finish once the paint is dry. With the first layer colour established, we're now ready to start building up the effect. And the first colour we need to do this is Cyberite Green, but I want to dilute it so it's nice and thin, so I'm going to mix it with Lamium Medium. I'm going to be using my medium layer brush to do this, and what we're looking to do is to use your palette to control this. Remember, always wash your brush before you get any of the medium so you don't contaminate it with any colour. And I'm looking for roughly the same amount, so get a good amount there, put that next to it, and then mix them together. So you're looking for a very thin colour, you're looking for it to be about this sort of consistency there. And the key thing here is to make sure that you don't apply too much at once so it doesn't kind of pool anywhere. So make sure you don't have too much of this on your brush before you begin. And when you're ready, what you're looking to do is, well, follow the box art for this. That gives you great points as to what exactly we're looking to do here. But I know on this facing of the spear blade in the center, what I'm looking for on this side on the left is to basically paint the middle of it. Now, you can see this first color is very thin, which is ideal because it's going to help with that nice transition between the different shades that we're looking for here. But basically, you just build it up a little bit in that middle part on that side. On the other side, I know the box art shows it's basically the top and the bottom like this. Now, I know it's very see-through at this point, but this is great because this is just the start of the effect and we're going to build it up from here. Once the first coat is completely dry, apply a second in the same way, the same mix, but this time just focus the colour a little bit closer towards the middle of each of these areas that you've established. So this way, you're building up a nice transition from Thunderhawk Blue to Cyberite Green. With that second coat dry, we're now finished with Cyberite Green and we can move on to adding the next colour. And this is going to be Fenrisian Grey, again diluted using Lamia Medium. And basically here we're looking to do much the same thing to bring certain areas up closer towards white. So this is going to be focused on all the areas where we painted Cyberite Green just a moment ago. So again, make sure you get your mix ready and we're looking to thin it down quite a lot with Lamia Medium. So about an equal amount there on the brush. Mix those together so I've got a very diluted colour. And again, like before, I'm looking to only apply a small amount of this at once so it doesn't sort of pool anywhere. So use your palette to control that and your tissue as well. There we go. And when you're ready, what we're looking to do is to paint this onto the areas where we put the Cyberite Green previously. Only this time, you're not going to cover all of it. Basically, what you're looking to do is to just leave some of that Cyberite Green showing and apply this on either side of it there like that. So we've got a very light amount of that colour on there. So we're getting a nice transition now from the Thunderhawk Blue up through Cyberite Green and on into Fenrisian Grey. Once the first coat's completely dry, add a second in the same way of the same mix, just focusing a little bit more towards the middle of each of these green areas to build up the colour even more. We've finished applying the Fenrisian Grey now, and you can see the effect is really building up, and we're on to the next colour now for it, which is going to be Ulthuan Grey, again applied in the same sort of way with Lamia Medium. Now I'm still using my medium layer brush for this, and once again what you've got to do is just get that nice mix on your palette. So make sure you put in plenty of medium. I'm going for, once again, about half and half. And there we go, that's just a case of mixing it together till you get to about that sort of consistency. And remember, this is all about making sure you don't put on too much at once. So get rid of the excess paint on your palette, and then it's just a case of identifying those areas where the colour's getting lighter, so just up here, and applying a thin coat on this area here, just keeping a nice transition going to the darker colours beneath. Though that initial application was very bright, you can see as it's dried, it's settled down into that blend. And all we've got to do is to finish off this part of it with, again, Ulthuan Grey, the same mix, and just focus this just towards the very centre and ends of these whiter areas that we've got. With that second coat dry, you can now see the effect on the blade is really building up nicely. However, there's just one last little thing to do with Ulthuan Grey, and that's to switch the Artificer brush to apply an edge highlight to all the sharpest corners of the blade. With that highlight applied, the blades are almost finished, and in fact there's just one more colour left to add just to finish them off, and that is going to be White Scar with a very fine highlight. This time I'm going straight to my Artificer brush because, well, this is just going to be a very small edge highlight. So make sure to get your paint ready and thinned down so it's nice and smooth. Make sure you don't have much on your brush, and all you're looking to do here is to add an edge highlight on the very sharpest parts of the spear. So basically it's the tip of each of the four blades, just a small amount, just going part way down there like that. And there we go, the spear is now complete, and the next detail, well, that's going to be the Talent of the Dwindling, because there's a green glow in the centre of that, so we need to paint that now. Now to do it, we're going to start out with a base coat of Caliban Green, then we're going to layer over it using Lauren Forest. After that, we're going to start to really build up that glow, beginning with a highlight of Baharoth Blue, then a much finer highlight of White Scar, before finishing off by bringing all those colours together with a Lamenter's Yellow Glaze. But starting out first of all with Caliban Green, I'm going to be using my small base brush to apply this, and this first colour is really to establish where the glow is actually going to be affecting. So make sure to thin your paint down, so I'm going to be applying it thinly, about that sort of consistency. There we go, make sure you don't have too much of it on your brush, and basically what we're looking to do is to paint around this kind of central stone that we've got in the middle of the palm of the hand just there. So I'm going to paint all of that, And then I'm going to work outwards so that really we're covering all of the palm and going part way onto the claws as well. So I'm going up to this kind of little ridge we've got at the base of them, just there like that. Now we also need to do the other side. So you just need to paint the back of it as well. In this case, you're looking at starting from the center and working your way outwards to around about the same area, just slightly less. With the base colour established, the next thing to do is to layer where the glow is going to be using Lauren Forest. And I'm basically looking at painting the same sort of areas with this colour, this time with a medium layer brush, and I am going to be applying two thin coats of this colour as well. The next colour to apply is Baharoth Blue, and now we're beginning to highlight this. Now what we need to do for this central little stone is basically lightly apply this colour so that you're keeping the recessed rune still with the darker colour showing. So just be really neat around this part here. But on the actual fingers and the rest of the talon, what you're looking to do is basically paint the more raised areas. So in the case of these fingers here, it's following this central ridge down the middle, there like that, picking it out with the brighter colour. The final layer colour to add for this is White Scar. This is just for that very fine highlight at the end, so I'm just going to use it to pick out some of the details of the stone in the centre, just avoiding the rune that we've got in the middle there so it stands out a bit more, and also just to pick out some of these more raised details in the talons close to the source of the light. Then finally, glaze all these colours with Lamenta's Yellow just to complete the effect and bring all those colours together. And there we are. With the glaze dry, the Talon of the Dwindling is complete, and there's just one more thing left to paint on Alariel, and that's her glowing eyes. Now we're going to go for a glowing blue effect for these, and to do it we're going to start off first of all by painting the eyeballs with White Scar. Then we're going to mix Gulliman Blue Glaze with Lamia Medium to get a nice soft blue glaze, and this is going to create the kind of glow around the actual eyes themselves. Then we're going to add just pure Gulliman Blue to the eyeballs to make them really strong blue, then we'll finish them off with a highlight of White Scar to complete the effect. But starting out with White Scar, using the Artificer brush, and in fact we're going to stick to the Artificer brush throughout this process because we need as much control as possible here, and we've got to make sure is that your paint's flowing smoothly and that you really don't have too much of it on your brush. You really do need that fine tip for this part. And so once you're ready, all you've got to do is hold the model as steadily as possible and just very gently touch the tip of the brush to the surface of the eye. There we go. Next, create a mix of Gulliman Blue and Lamia Medium, about 50-50, and then using your Artificer brush, apply this onto the eye and then just pull it down partway onto the cheek there and also under the brow to create a nice subtle blue glow. Once the mix is completely dry, the next thing to do is to add just Gulliman Blue on its own. This time, however, it's only focused on the actual eyeballs. And finally, we're going back to White Scar now just to finish off the eyes. And for this, all you've got to do is paint a small amount in the centre of each one. And once you've done this, well, all that remains to do is to make the final assembly of your miniature and then to base it. And as always, I recommend you base it in the same way as the rest of your army. There we are, Alariel the Ever Queen is complete, an absolutely beautiful model packed with detail that makes a perfect centrepiece for any Sylvaneth army. Now remember, the really key important things about painting this miniature, and well in fact any large miniature of this kind of complexity, is that you should always look for sub-assemblies as you're putting it together to make the painting process easier. And this is quite an extreme example of that, where we undercoated part of it with Korax White and part with Chaos Black, and well you can see the results, and that we've got a nice bright colour scheme on Alariel and that really nice dark carapace on the Wardroth Beetle. Now also, as you're handling this miniature, well be careful with it because it's actually got quite a lot of fragile details on it, so be aware of this so that you don't break any as you're painting it. And if you do, well you just need to get some super glue to fix it. And finally, we did use a lot of glaze and a lot of shade on this miniature. And when you are using these kind of paints, just bear in mind to put on the correct amount. It's very easy to put on too much, lose control of it, and in fact have it pool as it starts to dry. So just always keep that in mind and keep an eye out for it. And well, there you go. We really hope you've enjoyed this video because we've had loads of fun making it, not least because of all the cool different techniques we've got to use on the model. So have fun painting yours, and we'll see you again very soon. If you enjoyed that tutorial and you'd like to see more, then why not subscribe to our YouTube channel, Warhammer TV, which is full of loads of other tutorials, but also trailers and miniature showcases too.
If you want to watch some right now, why not check out some of the videos down below?